cursed jewelry. The most remarkable gemstones are produced once, under conditions of intense heat and pressure in the depths of the earth. From ancient times, people have been enthralled by these jewels due to their captivating brilliance and vivid colors. However, some diamonds have stories to tell that go beyond their obvious beauty. They are not merely valuable stones, but also fascinating objects because of the tales, stories, and legends associated with them. There are intriguing legends surrounding some of the most beautiful diamonds in history, including potential curses that have claimed the lives of numerous owners. Here we examine four jewels that have left a path of murder, betrayal, and mystery in their wake. Hope Diamond. Since diamonds have captivated people's attention for ages, it is not unexpected that legends and superstitions about their supposed benefits and drawbacks have developed. The Hope Diamond, a stunning blue diamond that weighs more than 45 carats, is one of the most remarkable jewels in the entire world. The stone, which is roughly the size of a walnut, is thought to be valued at $24.5 billion. Nonetheless, a lot of people would be reluctant to purchase it because it is supposedly cursed. In his book, The Unexplained, Carl Schuker describes the history of this precious stone. It gleamed on the forehead of an idol in an Indian temple until it was stealthily removed by a Hindu priest who was sentenced to a slow and excruciating death for this immoral deed. It was discovered in the Golconda mines near the Kistna River in southwest India, and it was purchased by a French trader in 1642, who then sold it to King Louis XIV for a healthy profit. However, the merchant was killed by a pack of wild dogs while carrying the artifact. Before it was taken in 1792 during the French Revolution, the diamond was owned by the French royal family. The beheaded Marie Antoinette and Louis XIV are frequently mentioned as examples of curse victims. The diamond was recut into a smaller gem after going missing for a few decades. Unverified rumors suggest that King George IV of Britain owned it, and his estate sold it to cover his massive debts. Henry Thomas Hope purchased the diamond in 1839, which is how it gained its name. The diamond changed hands with multiple owners after Hope's passing. Soap opera writers would struggle to come up with a more horrific story than the catastrophe linked to the diamond. Owners killed themselves, committed suicide, and lost everything they had invested in. In addition to paper cuts and unhappy marriages, those who came into contact with the diamond also likely experienced drug addiction, lunacy, and poor hair days. It turns out that the Hope Curse was essentially a fantastic tale fabricated by reporters in the late 1800s to boost newspaper sales. Many of the other tragedies connected to the stone are little more than rumors, even if some of the owners are known to have actually met violent ends, Marie Antoinette's guillotine beheading being a famous example. Similar to other well-known curses, such the Pharaoh's Curse, sometimes referred to as King Tut's Curse, it is possible to create an ominous history for the Hope Diamond by looking into its past and emphasizing everything negative. As almost everyone, at least any adult who is old and wealthy enough to possess such an expensive gem, experiences some sort of unfortunate incident, be it an illness, accident, or family member passing away, it is easy to compile a list of these occurrences and link them to the Hope Diamond. The Black Orlov. Like a classic Hollywood movie, the history of the seventh largest black diamond ever recovered is full of twists and turns, larger-than-life personalities, conspiracies, gray zones, and little white lies. The fabled stone will always draw attention and captivate with all of its mystery. There are rumors that the Black Orlov committed three suicides in the first part of the year, 1900s. In the first, the expensive diamond was brought to the U.S. in 1932 by a European diamond merchant by the name of J.W. Paris. Not long after he successfully closes the diamond deal, he hangs himself from a Fifth Avenue building. Just one tiny, annoying fact, though. There is no official record of this occurring, though it is undoubtedly the prevailing narrative. 15 years later, Paris is unintentionally drawn into the notorious diamond curse by two Russian princesses who were formerly owners of the Black Orlov. The two royals are said to have fallen to their deaths in 1947 after leaving Russia to live in Europe. However, just like the others, there is significant doubt about even their identities. Leonila Galitsine Baryatinsky was the first princess. However, the sole woman in Europe with that name had passed away in 1918 in Switzerland at the age of 102. The second princess had the same name, Orlov. It's also true that Princess Nadezhda Petrovna Orlov did, in fact, reside in Europe during that period. However, she would have been in her late 80s, which is an unusually young age for a lady to take her own life due to heartbreak, as it was purportedly claimed. Overall, the Black Orlov's account simply doesn't match up. One might easily envisage this strange tale of the Black Diamond Beauty as a mystery TV show where viewers would be left guessing until the next minute about what would happen to it. Felicity Huffman should undoubtedly be cast in the Black Orlov narrative if it is ever produced by Hollywood. The Daily Sapphire. Curator Peter Tandy had no idea the odd scenario that was about to unfold when he landed upon an ordinary purple amethyst in a Natural History Museum gemstone cabinet. The Delhi purple sapphire was given to the museum and had been lying untouched for 30 years after being mistakenly labeled as a sapphire in the 19th century. Peter took the gem out of its box and underneath he discovered a little letter. That note unveiled a startling story of tragedy. This seemingly innocuous stone was referred to as trebly cursed and went on to become one of the most fascinating displays in the history of the museum. India was thrown into disarray in 1857 when a rebellion against the British caused havoc and damage throughout the nation. The British army put an end to the rebellion eventually, but not before a boiling pot of hatred and bitterness erupted, taking many lives. In the end, it made the British reevaluate how they felt about other people's traditions and practices. But in the near run, the British Army sought to make a strong statement and exacted revenge on the people of India. It was common during this time for British soldiers to steal valuables and treasures back home and for temples and palaces in India to be robbed. The Indra Temple at Kanpur, Kanpur, was one of these temples. The temple was devoted to Indra, the Hindu god of thunder and battle. Colonel W. Ferris, a Bengal cavalryman, grabbed what he thought to be a purple sapphire from the temple before departing India. Then he went back to his family's house. Ferris's financial difficulties started as soon as he got back to England, pushing the family to the verge of bankruptcy. When all of the family members began to have severe ailments, Ferris initially placed the responsibility on his own bad decisions. However, this is when his attention was drawn to the gem. When he leased the stone to a family friend who mysteriously took his own life, his suspicions were validated. Edward Heron Allen acquired custody of the gem by 1890. One of the most renowned academics of his era was Heron Allen. He was a scientist, writer, and polymath with a wide range of interests and skills. Superstition would absolutely not have an effect on Heron Allen. Maybe because he was such a sensible man, he accepted the stone from Ferris's struggling son in 1890. This sensible scientist quickly disregarded logic and started attributing a string of negative occurrences to the stone's curse after obtaining the diamond. Heron Allen had the curse tied with a silver ring shaped like a double-headed snake in an attempt to negate its potency. In addition, he fastened two amethyst scarab beetles and engraved zodiac symbols on the ring. The only indication that the stone was cursed in the years that followed was the presence of a Hindu yogi ghost haunting Heron Allen. Seeking the sapphire fervently, the yogi materialized in the family's study. Heron Allen grudgingly consented to lend the Delhi sapphire to a friend in 1902. The friend was hit hard by a string of unfortunate incidents right away. When he gave the diamond back to Heron Allen, bad things started to happen to him again almost instantly. He threw the stone into Regent's Canal out of exasperation. Heron Allen had to have thought he was finally free of the curse. Sadly, the sapphire had different plans. The ring was removed from the canal and brought to a nearby jeweler a few months later. The jeweler knew right away that stone to be the one he had set on Heron Allen's ring. He gave the ring back, thinking that he was being kind. Heron Allen lent the jewel out again when a friend asked to borrow it. This time, the unhappy receiver was a singer in the music industry who, after donning the cursed diamond, never sang again. Heron Allen, frustrated, crammed the Delhi sapphire into 7 charm-filled boxes. He then placed it in his bank's safe and gave orders that it not be opened until after his passing. Cursing Stone. A massive stone bearing a curse was placed in the underpass close to the Tully House Museum in Carlisle in 2001. Andy Altman made it, and local Carlisle artist Gordon Young designed it. The text was taken from Glasgow's 16th century Archbishop Gavin Dunbar's book, The Monition of Cursing. The curse was pronounced on all pulpits across the disputed territory, the Scottish border, in an attempt to drive out the local reaver families, who were known for their rapes, murders, and thefts. Strangely enough, though, a few Carlisle locals attributed some of the city's unfortunate incidents to the stone and its purported occult abilities. The curse, now called The Monition of Cursing, was written by Archbishop Dunbar with the intention of having it read aloud in every church on the Scottish side of the border as a warning to the reaving families. If they didn't go back to the church and stop robbing others, it cursed them to burn in hell. There were other curses placed on the reaving families before Dunbar's. The Bishop of Durham, Richard Fox, condemned the reavers of Tynedale, Northumberland in 1498 and prohibited any clergymen from receiving them into the church. The Cursing Stone of Carlisle was installed in 2000 as a part of the Millennium Festivities. However, a Christian minority quickly took offense, viewing the stone and the curse as derogatory remarks against Christianity. They insisted that the stone be destroyed in addition to being taken out. Fortunately, common sense prevailed, and the stone is still in place. Kohinoor Diamond. The diamond was separated from the sand thousands of years ago in India's alluvial mines. Hindu mythology holds that it was worshipped by gods such as Krishna, despite the fact that its owner's luck seemed to indicate that it was cursed. The diamond, which would later be called the Kohinoor Diamond, made its way through court intrigues in India before, by the middle of the 1800s, finding its way into the British crown jewels. At that time, a British amateur geologist conducted interviews with gemologists and historians to learn more about the diamond's provenance. He then penned the Kohinoor's history, which became the foundation for most subsequent accounts of the stone. Historians William Dalrymple and Anita Anand, however, contend that the geologist was entirely incorrect. Are these stones really cursed, or are the stories fabricated myths? Leave a comment below letting us know your thoughts.